But in real life, Julia Barr prizes time at her suburban New Jersey home, minutes from New York City.
It's a very comfortable place, and we've intentionally always kept it that way.
Julia and her husband, Richard Hirschlag, spotted their 5,000-square-foot home in the spring of 1998. The exterior wasn't quite their style, but the interior got their attention.
Julia went to see it, and that day called me up and said, we've got to get a deposit now. The inside is really just what we want.
What they wanted was a gallery-like space with plenty of light and a contemporary feel, something that would allow the furnishings to get more attention than the architecture. The challenge was creating coziness and warmth.
Our own style has wound it up, you know, just because it is eclectic and it does have certain whimsy, so the feel of those things change the tenor of the house as opposed to if it were strictly sleek.
Smoothness mixed with texture. That's what keeps this retro-inspired living room in tune. Classic chrome and leather chairs, the work of architect and designer Mies van der Rohe, coupled with a fuzzy shag rug, and an ultra-sleek fireplace topped with layered art.
People would come over and go, oh, is that new? Is that new? And it was just that the house really lent itself to showing pieces off and having a place where it actually fit and was enhanced in the area.
The modern sofa is covered in a synthetic fabric that mimics the look and feel of suede. A chenille-covered chair nearby is a clever European design. It's a convertible chair, and yes, it converts. One, two, three. In one corner, a miniature clothing display made from cloth and metal is sculptural and fascinating. In an opposite corner, a dressmaker form is part of the eclectic look in the room and a reminder that the people who live here choose things that make them laugh.
We have a house in Cape Cod, and we go to Provincetown when we're there, and there was this little store, and it had this thing sitting there, and we said, could we take it?
A set of stairs off the entranceway to the home leads to the couple's formal dining room. To Julia and Richard, formality is translated with a combination of styles, some from Europe, some from the Far East.
Our dining room is a mix of a lot of different styles.
A Scandinavian bench against one wall gets its color from Indian pillows. Across the room, relief art from Arizona adds depth and interest. In the center of the space, a roughly hewn table is updated with a coat of white paint.
The chairs are actually from Indonesia, and they're rattan with a steel frame.
A modern lighting system fits quietly into the room, its cables suspended for a bright and dramatic look. Two Turkish runners laid side by side give the illusion of one larger rug under the table. Some of the pieces are picked up during travels, others come from catalogs. For Julia and Richard, it's the look and feel of the space that's important, nothing else.
When you see it, it all sort of seems to flow together very nicely.
Near the dining room, a charming greenhouse looks out onto the yard. This is Julia's private space for orchid growing.
The greenhouse was here, actually, when we moved here, and we kept thinking, oh, we don't want this greenhouse, you know, we'll just, you know, we'll expand, we'll do something. And gradually, we started to use it and put things in it, and now we love it.
Family time is spent in the den, another room that cleverly pushes the boundaries by combining Southwestern and modern themes.
The den's very cozy. It's not particularly large. It's plenty comfortable for us.
Because the room is smaller than other rooms in the house, the couple chose scaled-down furniture with curvy, rounded shapes. A thick flocati, or wool rug, is playful and casual and adds even more softness to the space.
Everything has a texture in that room.
Hand-woven baskets and twig tables contrast the modern furniture and keep this family room from becoming a formal room.
It is not a formal space. None of our homes ever have been formal. Even if there are areas that we don't use just because they have a little more formal ambiance.
Each room in this four-bedroom house has a look all its own. Casual, worldly, modern. And yet, there is a sense of balance and flow. It's a place that captures the heart of a family and follows the number one rule of soaps. No decor is perfect without a little drama.
We socialize, and we go out, and we go to dinner, and we go to the theater, we get together with friends, but our home is really our haven.
all my children, Brooke English is constantly surrounded by turmoil and angst. In contrast, actress Julia Barr, in her exquisitely decorated New Jersey home, surrounds herself with family and a few special friends.
We'll start with the dog. The dog is Nell. She's going to be 5. She's a mixed breed, German Shepherd, and who knows what else. We have 2 cats who are both 10. Then we have the parakeet. We have Lewis, our lop-eared rabbit. And then we have about 9, I think, assorted goldfish in the pond outside. There they go. I'm probably out there at least 3 times a day to feed them and just sort of hang out. It's very cathartic because there's a waterfall. Well, it's like being, you know, stepping outside into this wonderful sort of forest garden. When we first moved here, I thought, well, I don't want a greenhouse. The more we sort of sat with the greenhouse, I thought, you know, I've always loved orchids and I had tried to regrow them, but this was a perfect spot.
This is the den, which we love because it's very cozy and it's a big gathering place for all of us. We started collecting snow domes, shakers, and the collection got huge, so we reduced it to the very selected few. And then the 2 shelves below that are glass sculpture, which my daughter created.
My daughter goes, yes, my parents love decorating. And I went, that sounds so superficial, honey. But we enjoy it. This is the living room, which is full of items that we've sort of collected and purchased over the years. We like sculptural, architectural pieces. The table is very architectural. We've always loved the Barcelona chair, so we finally got a set. This is a great piece. It's called a rataplan. We've had this for ages, and it actually, the 2 sides come up to form like a chair with arms. And we like whimsy. If you'll see, there's things like a dress form mannequin. The chair, the spine of the picked for playing guitar. We loved it. We tend to buy art when we travel. Like this piece is called The Pool, and it comes from a gallery in Scottsdale, Arizona.
This is a piece that we purchased when we were in Sundance, Utah. This piece is actually carved from a rubbing of the pyramid at Chichen Itza. And I think this was at a gallery in Nantucket, and it's a sleeping cat, which we thought was appropriate because it's sleeping, and this is the bedroom. I buy pillows the same way I put on lipstick. I keep putting on lipstick until I get the shade I want. I just keep buying pillows until I get the combination, and they all work together. It's just what finally appeals to our eye. As you come down the stairs and go into the den, there's a carved out area, and I keep them by the door because they're very heavy and make an excellent weapon. Have you ever picked them up? It's a welcoming sort of home, so I'm always glad to walk in the door at the end of the day. I'd love to come home.
Laura are about to renew their vows, but first, they have to make it through the Halloween-themed rehearsal dinner. They don't realize it, but the costumes worn by the bride, the groom, and Greenlee, the groom's ex-girlfriend, reveal their hidden agendas.
Laura's Little Miss Muffet looks perfect. She's controlling everything. Greenlee is a gorilla. Is going to bust this wide open. She's the gorilla in the corner. She's like, here's what's really happening. Leo is a prisoner trapped in this situation.
Don't ever leave me.
Leo, I love you.
No one's ever loved you like I do.
I never stop loving you, Leo.
He's just really, really confused. He's, you know, he still, of course, has feelings for Greenlee, and
He wants to love Laura the way he loves Greenlee. So it's tough. It's trying him to the point where the easiest thing for him to do is just get out.
My head is gonna explode. I swear to God, I'm gonna self-destruct.
He's always been a character that will just get out of something. He's, you know, all that charm and everything. Well, now he's in a situation where everything he's usually done doesn't work. He also doesn't know what he's up against.
You selfish bitch!
Leo's caught between two women who both love him and who will both plot, lie, and scheme to get what they want.
She has set Greenlee up to make it so that Leo thinks that Greenlee's crazy, you know? So it's this weird kind of back and forth. Greenlee and Laura are almost competing to convince Leo that the other is crazy.
You're happy little homemaker, your perfect mate, that model of mental health. She tried to kill me.
I think Greenlee is not really going after him to, like, get him back. She's sort of trying to, like, trip up Laura to make him see that she's not right for him, and Greenlee is.
His feelings for Greenlee went a lot deeper than anything he's probably had. As much as he tries to get away from it, it just doesn't, it's not that easy.
Greenlee, for Leo, is passion, excitement, recklessness. Laura is being a real man, living up to your promises.
Earlier this year, as Laura awaited a heart transplant, Leo promised her mother that he would always love her daughter.
I'll do anything for her.
Can you love her?
I think that he felt that he could love Laura at some point, but you can't force something like that, and I think he's finally realizing it.
Ah, the truth.
There's a big change coming. This simply can't last. I mean, the tension created between the three of them can't exist, so there has to be an explosion, and it's coming soon.
Along came a spider who sat down beside her. Will Miss Muffet win the heart of Leo Dupre?
I think there's a real dynamic there, and once Leo is convinced that Greenlee loves Jake, he'll be fine with me, you know? I think.
They were some of all my children's most beloved characters. Natalie Dillon, killed in a car crash. Cindy Chandler, died of AIDS.
She looked right into my heart. And she was gone.
Jesse Hubbard, caught in a shootout. And Travis Montgomery, died of a stroke. Now, in an unusual twist, these characters have returned to offer guidance to a recently departed Pine Valley resident. Last month, Jillian Lavery took a bullet meant for Anna Devane, and her husband Ryan was faced with the toughest decision of his life. Should he take his beloved princess off life support and donate her heart to Laura, who desperately needed a transplant?
Come back to me.
Now, after Jillian's death, her heart beats on in Laura, and Ryan's life has become a living hell. Jillian's transition to heaven is turning out to be quite a struggle, too.
Where am I? What's happening to me?
She doesn't want to be dead. She wants to be with Ryan.
I have to go back to Ryan.
Jillian is unresolved and therefore can't move on to a full heaven place, so they've crafted a transitional place. Many of us are back to help her through the transition.
My name is Travis Montgomery. I think you know my daughter, Bianca.
There are some of us who have passed on but haven't reached the ultimate in heaven. What we're doing is helping other individuals make the transition.
Jillian has some sort of lesson that she has to learn.
It will all be made clear in time.
And there are people who are connected to her in ways that she may not even understand that are there to help her learn that lesson.
While Jillian's heavenly holding place has a minimalist look, it took a massive amount of preparation to design the set.
We have to allow 10 working days for the building of a set. The set is built and painted and electrified. We have a prop crew and a carpenter crew and electricians. We're easily over 100 people altogether.
There's an elevator that goes up and goes down, all the way down.
Well, you cannot go down in that elevator. That's the express to the bottom. And I do mean the very bottom.
It can take you either up or down. So, you know, it's important what kind of decisions you make in this heaven waiting area.
I added a clock face that becomes quite significant. It doesn't have any hands, but the pendulum of the clock is a swing with a woman swinging in it. It makes the time a mystery.
But there was nothing mysterious about costume designer Richard Schurkamp's heavenly creations.
We just tried to do a heightened, exaggerated, idealized version of what they would have worn in life.
Hello, Jillian.
For Cindy, kind of a very sweet Grace Kelly 1950s thing.
That's very fitting to what Cindy was like. She was just always this, you know, brave, feminine heroine in the face of whatever her problems were.
For Natalie, something much more sophisticated and glamorous.
Natalie always dressed well, didn't she? And I think in heaven, she is still dressing well.
For Travis, a perfect business suit.
I didn't know whether we were going to be wearing sheets and going boo and pasty-faced or what.
Jesse, very urban type of thing that he wore when he was on the show, but in white.
It's grand, you know? I mean, the costumes and the people. And I love the fact that they kept me true to form.
As Jillian struggles with her transition to heaven, actress Esta Terblanche looks forward to what lies ahead.
I'm very excited about this whole storyline because it happens in real life. People die. People stay behind. They can't accept it.
Please, she would want the same for you. You must let her go.
So I think people will be interested in that storyline.
The infamous Pine Valley, where I've uncovered some things that will shock you. First, my day began in wardrobe.
So I'm playing a reporter.
That's where I bumped into the buff Cameron Matheson.
Just getting my wardrobe for the day here.
Oh, this is great. What are you playing today?
Just, you know, regular hero type stuff on the show.
A little script review. Then I made my way to the set, got a little makeup.
I still feel like Lisa Gibbons right now.
My co-stars John Callahan, Terry Ivins, and Thank Julia you. Barr were so supportive.
You're an idiot!
Rehearsal was a breeze.
Yeah, guys, we had a 10 o'clock meeting. Everyone's waiting. Don't laugh, just for the laugh.
Daytime drama is serious business. Actors have to learn up to 40 pages of dialogue every night. And those soap secrets I told you about are tough to keep, like how Terry Ivins makes herself cry.
I have to breathe a little bit, and then it just starts to happen. And then you go, I love you. I want you to stay. Please.
Oh my God, she's really crying.
all right. Well, I gave it a shot with salt from a bottle of eye drops.
This is the happiest I've ever been.
And how about the steamy soap kiss?
Actually, that's the happiest I've ever been.
And during a tour of the set, Finola Hughes showed me how to take it like a man.
As I come up, you're gonna whoosh, go away.
Practice makes perfect, and she needs a little more. She actually hit me.
Oh,
I did touch you.
I felt that one.
From a sandy beach to the town hospital, Pine Valley has it all, even the dramatic soap tag.
It's the closure to the scene, and you have to little punch it up a little bit. That's the tag.
I thought you were in love with me.
Well, I'm not.
Well, daytime TV will never be the same.
Our next guest is a two-time Emmy Award winner. She has played Brooke English for 25 years. Hard to believe, on the long-running soap opera, All My Children, my favorite. So, take a look.
That's why holding you feel so familiar.
Both of them. Please welcome back to the show, Julia Barr. Hi, how are you, Julia?
Good
to see you. Here, look.
Yes, I know.
I know, it's good.
I remember your show as being so short people friendly.
It is.
That, you know, you can...
It's not even just short people, because I'm tall, but I have short legs.
So, well, I'm short, and I have short legs.
There you go. So it's perfect,
perfect
for you.
Perfect, perfect.
It's hard to believe you've been on that show 25 years.
I don't have a concept for time anymore. I don't know whether it's because I'm, you know, I have a family, I have a daughter. I don't know how to judge time. Like, is it, you know, like, 1 year was the year I was married to Tad, or was it the year my husband and I went to, you know, like, Montana, you know, it's like two different time frames.
They're all shot up. Yeah, that's,
right.
It's all confusing, I bet. But this character is always great.
Thank
She's always been good, Brooke.
Oh, you're always great.
No, but you always loved Brooke English from the get-go. You know, she was a sweet girl, and remember when she knocked on Phoebe's door and said, Hi, I'm your niece.
I'm here. I've been kicked out of girls' school. Could I stay with you for a while?
No, yeah, that's been a long while.
Right.
How is your daughter? She's going to college now, right?
She graduated.
She graduated high school.
Right.
Yeah.
She'll be starting in the fall.
No kidding.
Yeah.
Is she going to go away or stay close?
I think she's going to be on the
East Coast, which is good for you. Right?
Yeah. I think I would have a very hard time if she were halfway across the country. It would be, you know, because she's our one and only.
Right. Mm, right.
Yeah.
And is it going to be sad when she goes off to college in a little bit, you know?
For 20 minutes. No, I'm kidding. No. You know, it's funny. Well, you know, you have kids, you get used to separations all along the way. You know, they go to school, then they sometimes go away to camp, and then they do other things. So you're sort of ready for the separation. I think the hard thing is that it's what the separation means, that it really is the next step in their life.
Right.
And I think that's like, please don't make me go there because
I can imagine.
Yeah.
I got all, you know, choked up when
when kids start to school.
I know. When my little daughter walked into pre-K this year, and she's not, she walked right in, bye, Mom. I was like, and I hear her say to her friend, my mom's a mess. I was a mess, you know?
Oh, that's so sweet.
Was she a good kid grade-wise? Did she study hard?
Yeah, she's the last year she was in school as a senior, she carried 4 APs.
Wow.
She had the lead in her school musical, Little Me. I was so impressed with her ability to handle a lot of things and with grace and style and enjoy it at the same time.
So she can sing like you can sing.
She has, I like her voice tremendously more than I like mine. She has a great voice.
Last time you were here, you were on your way out to sing at the Yankee game, right?
Yes.
And how did that go?
Oh, my Lord. That was the...
Oh, hello. That's sorry. Okay. That's all right.
I killed myself. It was the most exciting thing I think I've ever done because it's so the feeling of, you know, being on that field and everybody stands up and, you know, the hand on the heart. The disconcerting thing was because it's such a big arena.
Echo.
The echo. It's a 1 second delay. So not only did I have earplugs, I also had my fingers in my ears so that I couldn't hear, wow.
Yeah, yeah.
It was
a lot. You've seen a lot of people do that and have trouble staying on.
It's very disconcerting, but it was the thrill of a lifetime.
And are you going to be singing more, you think? Are you going to do a record or
since
something?
Since you ask, my husband and I know you know he's an oral surgeon because we all like teeth.
Exactly.
He's also he's a very excellent musician, and we're starting to work on a project. We're going to produce a Christmas CD. I hope it's going to be ready for this Christmas and probably offer it on my website. And the proceeds will go to charity. I don't know if you know, I'm involved with the Fund for Animals, mm-hmm. and I've also been involved with a lot of the September 11th Fund. So the CD is going to be oriented that way.
Well, that's a wonderful thing.
Yeah,
and it's great
when
you know you can make a difference or help in that way.
So much. Yeah.
Have you been down there? I have not. Have you?
Believe it or not, my singing teacher and my daughters moved down there recently. So that was the first time I'd been. It's the cleanup that they've done is amazing. You know, all that work, but it's this space, and you know what was there.
Right.
You know.
So. It's still hard to believe sometimes for me.
I think it's true for everybody. Yeah. It's like there's a. You still know that, you know this. Event on September 11th, but there's some distance there, you know, but I think it's a good thing to always, you know.
Never forget.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can never forget. It's one of those times where the rest of your life, you'll say where you were the moment you heard.
Totally.
You know.
Totally.
Yeah, it's wild, and to have to explain it to kids. The Fund for Animals, what is that? It helps animals that are rescued?
Well, the Fund for Animals is an organization that was started, I think, 1967 by Cleveland Amory, and it has several types of rescue facilities all over the United States. Some are for horses, some are for exotic animals. The one here in Manhattan is a spay and neutering clinic because...
Oh, great. So important.
Well, overpopulation is why so many animals end up in shelters. I mean, we've gotten a lot of our animals from shelters, you know, because they've been abandoned or people can't take care of them. But on my website, we put out a fund fact page every month, which is all about animals, whether it's a loss of a pet, whether it's how to deal with wildlife that end up in your backyard, like, that's something that gets stranded, you don't know what to do. You know, the obvious pros of having your pets neutered, just all kinds of things. We have a celebrity Q&A about people and their relationship with their pet companions.
I'd love to do that.
Oh, would you?
Yes, I've got the two doggies, yes. And I'm getting another dog.
I would love it if you,
Yesterday, in the audience, I was saying that I need a big dog to be friends with Nick, and this woman said she had just moved to the city, and she had a Labrador, and she was not going to be able to keep it, and boom, we made a connection.
What are your dogs now? What are your two dogs?
I have Nicky from the pound,
and
he's a German Shepherd.
They all are, German Shepherd mix.
Something, And then my daughter has a little Chihuahua, because she wanted one that would stay a baby her whole life.
Right, that's a good choice.
So Chelsea and I will love to do a little interview.
I would love that. I really would.
She draws in class. She draws herself and Cloudy, her dog, and she always draws him as a person. And the teacher goes, isn't it a dog? She goes, no, it's really more like my baby. How cute is that?
Yeah, I think it's a great relationship. You know, when a child has an animal companion, you learn a lot about yourself, and you learn a lot about life and, you know, all kinds of things. So
yeah, I thought
great.
She was too young to do it, but boy, she is loving every minute of it. JuliaRoseBar.com is where you can find out all about that. Listen,
right.
In case I don't see you before the show's done, thank you for always being such a great guest.
Oh, thank you so much. It's been a pleasure.
Julia Barr, we'll be right back with Rob Morrow.
We're sitting here with Eva LaRue Callahan, and we're going to find out, were you nervous coming back to All My Children? You haven't been there.
Yeah, I haven't been there in almost 5 years.
So it's a role that, you know, I mean, do you pick up right where you left off, or you're in a different place now?
Yeah, I'm kind of in a different place because I'm not sure who she's going to be.
Right.
So she may be different. She may be, you know, she may be Maria. She may not be. So, but I was more nervous about coming back because I didn't know as many people there anymore.
See, that's what, yeah, are you
Sarah
nervous
Geller
when you
was
walk
gone,
in?
And Teresa right. Blake was gone, and Kelly was still there, and Julia Barr was still there, and my husband was still there, and, you know, all these people, they were all gone, and it was really a great little fraternity over there when I first started. It was so much fun. So I felt nervous about coming back, but everybody's just been so great. They've been so sweet and so welcoming, and so it's been really, yeah, it felt like
How
I haven't been gone at all.
How is it working with your husband? That's what I gotta know. How is it working? I mean, because it's tough. I mean, it's a tough business. You're there every day. What's
it
like?
It, you know, it's really great because we get a chance. We get along really well, so we spend a lot of time together. But when you are working with your husband, they get a chance to put in all their 2 cents all during your normal daily life. So suddenly they get a chance to put in their 2 cents in your work life.
And that's not good.
And you're doing the scene together or you're rehearsing, and he's famous for this. You're not going to do it like that, are you?
Oh!
Like, I was thinking about it.
Oh!
Thinking, well, I guess I'm not going to now, but...
But you guys have always been love interests. That's good. Now, do you think, what happens if John went off with another character? Would that bother you at all?
Well, he is. He's supposed to be marrying somebody. Marrying
Brooke. How do you feel
about that? Bar.
How do you feel?
Actually, I think I think it's great. And they had storyline together before, and they almost get, so they work really brilliantly together. And Julia Barr is a wonderful lady.
Well, that helps.
She's really fabulous. Oh, yeah. She's really
definitely.
Cool.
She's run the community center, cared for her Aunt Phoebe, been a devoted mom to son Jamie, and has fought to help kids in need.
Are you okay? I mean, you think you can go to class?
On All My Children, Brooke English has been known for helping others, a quality also found in Julia Barr, who's portrayed her for many years.
I've been the spokesperson for the Fund for Animals since March of 2000. The organization has wonderful agencies that address animal protection. Here in New York, it's the Have a Heart Spaying and Neutering Clinic.
Have a Heart is a small but perfect part of Julia's favorite fund.
Hello.
On a yearly basis, 10 to 12 million animals are put to sleep because there's such an overpopulation. One of the best ways to address it is to start at the beginning.
Julia has been so remarkably supportive of the Fund for Animals. In fact, half of the battle is being able to spread the awareness. She's so effective with her website. Julia is our angel of mercy.
I grew up with animals. There was a dog in my life from the time I was born. When I left home and went to college, I had my first cat. Now our household includes 2 more cats, a dog, a lop-eared rabbit. It's pretty intense.
How are you? How are you feeling? Okay.
There's a relationship there that doesn't really exist in any other form. You know, when they talk about unconditional love that you get from an animal, that really is true. But I think it fills a certain part of us in a very specific way.
And it's been very fulfilling for Julia.
Animals have always been an important part of my life. And I think when something is important to you, you want to do the best job you can in taking care of that animal. We are the only ones that can speak for them. That's a good feeling.
After many years on All My Children, Brooke English has shown off her animal instinct.
It was nothing. It was just a fling.
But while in real life, actress Julia Barr is crazy for critters, she was a little nervous about singing their praises.
I had a fair amount of anxiety about doing this.
But generous Julia put anxiety aside in the name of a good cause and recorded a CD of holiday favorites. It's something that's sure to bring cheer to her fans and her favorite charity, the Fund for Animals.
The Fund for Animals is an organization that Cleveland Amory started in 1967, and they lobby for all kinds of animal rights.
Every year in the United States, millions of dogs and cats are put to death simply because there are not enough homes for them.
Even the CD sleeve has special meaning for Julia. It features a drawing of her much-loved pooch named Nell.
Nell was a dog that we adopted from a shelter almost 6 years ago, and she developed cancer that was untreatable. She passed away this last January, and it was very difficult.
The CD was a family affair involving her husband, Dr. Richard Hirschlag.
He, single-handedly, and this is not an exaggeration, is responsible for all of the arrangements, for all of the artwork. I would have not done it without him.
And daughter Allison, who didn't mind piping in for her mom's pet project.
My daughter lends her beautiful voice to three of the songs also.
Julia's legion of fans were eager to show their support and snapped up signed copies to take home.
These are all members of the Lady Gray Society and the Brooke Edmond Group, and they have been loyal supporters, and they're here because of the CD. I bought it and listened to it and loved the fact that the proceeds go for the fund and the shelter. There are so many people also that, you know, are sort of happy to have this because, it's, you know, it benefits the fund, and it's an All My Children thing, and it's a Julie Barr thing, so it's been great.
Thank you for coming by.
No doubt this holiday season will be merry and bright for Julia, her fans, and her adorable following of furry friends. David Canary wears many hats, has multiple Emmys. He plays two of the most popular characters on television. And after years of honing his craft on the set of ABC's All My Children, David is just hitting his stride.
I act what I feel, and I love it. I love the feeling, and that's why I'm so lucky to be an actor. Acting to me is almost swimming through an energy field, almost like water. If I don't feel something, really feel it, then I can't do it.
He's done it all right, ever since the day he showed up for his screen test.
I was supposed to have a screen test scene with Erica Kane. Well, Erica Kane was sick that morning. They got Julia Barr to stand in for her. After a few moments, Jackie Babin came striding across the studio floor, threw her arms open like this, walked right by me and hugged Julia Barr and said, "You were wonderful, darling." And she said, "You," and looked at me, "we'll talk."
Nothing matters, Liza, nothing. None of it.
I don't really agree with a good deal of what he has to say. He's just too uptight and too angry. Stuart, on the other hand, usually doesn't talk nearly as much as Adam does, and he's just a much more relaxed character.
It always looks so sad when I pluck him out of the water. The reason I throw him back is because the water is the fish's home.
I love Stuart. I'm very glad that I get a chance to play him, to be him. And I'm probably more like him than I am Adam.
I find it incredible to believe that he's closer to the nice one. He does the bad one so well.
I was kind of hoping we could go flying tomorrow.
I'm sorry. For the next few weeks, I'm going to be tied up.
He's a very poor father. He wants so badly to be a good father, but his own anger and his own defenses get in the way. He's a bum.
Unlike Adam, who loves to rock the boat, David prefers smooth sailing.
I try not to make waves. I really want to slide through life as unnoticed as possible. But in my actor life, I want to make it as complicated as possible. And that's why I think that's why I get so happy about acting, because I get to make waves. I'm paid to make waves.
What do you do if you're the daughter of one of daytime's superstars?
I don't know.
Why, follow in her footsteps, of course.
Can it be that simple?
Well, how would you know? You just got back together.
That's what Alison Herskoff did as Lizzie on The Guiding Light, even though her mother, All My Children's Julia Barr, had misgivings about her choice.
Honey, I didn't know that you'd still be here.
Having been in this business a long time, you know that, you know, it has certain ups and downs, and you sort of have to be able to go with the flow.
I mean, I feel so stupid.
Growing up, Alison never really focused on her mom's acting ability.
Of course, we would talk about what we did at work or at school that day, at the dinner table, but I was never inclined to think about it. I didn't connect it with what I did. I didn't connect it with life in general, because she's my mom.
But the acting bug bit anyway, in the seventh grade.
I auditioned for the weirdest little play called Pegora the Witch.
It was such a cute role. It fit her perfectly.
Julia recognized her daughter's dedication and soon gave in.
We have an independent part to our nature. We don't like people messing with us. We like to do our thing our own way, you know. Because I know, like, honey, can I help you? Honey, can I help you? She goes, leave me alone.
Nothing okay. is ever finished. We're both perfectionists.
The jump from school plays to soap opera days wasn't planned.
I said, maybe they have some extra work. It would just be good to meet a casting director. Beforehand, they said, well, they would like her to read for this role. And I went, well, we both went,
it happened
whoa.
So fast. It was ridiculous.
Reckless.
So quickly that Alison had a few things to learn.
Well, that was one thing I should have asked you about, was how the lighting works, because I'm so used to turning out and stage blocking, but what you really have to be concerned about is where the lights are and how it's going to hit you, and in case
you were standing in the light.
And Grant is just so tall, so, I mean, just yesterday we were trying to figure out this hug, because every time I moved, this light was in his shoulder.
Hi, Daddy.
But others have noticed that Alison has taken to the tricks of the trade.
I got a comment actually yesterday. We've been watching your work, and I just have to tell you, you're one of the most beautiful Lizzies we've seen. I mean, it feels good, but it's still weird.
And now that they're both on soaps, has their relationship changed?
It's changed from want some gum. Do you want some gum? Can I get you a drink?
Are you drinking enough water today? I said, honey, I'll be 90 and in the home, and you come to visit me, I'm going to go, did you have enough water
today? I really won't be surprised. Even if you're senile, you'll remember that.
Oh, I get it. I'm supposed to tell the truth, but you...
It's a role that's likely to continue, just like Alison.
Daytime is great. It really is.
And it's because of you.
So you commit yourself to what you're doing today and have it justified. And if it's not justified, they're very flexible around here. They'll let us... kind of semi-rewrite scenes. If we're really doing serious rewriting, we have to submit it well in advance. But to change lines, to insert, to take out some words, to change a line or two, they're very flexible that way. And that's very helpful to the actors, some of us more than others. Michael Knight has not read a line the way it was written since I've known him, and that's 21 years. Mm-hmm. But he comes up with better ones.
After that, you moved on to many, many, many storylines. But as I sat down and looked at the names of all the people that you'd worked with, I had forgotten how many times Adam has been married. I lost count after about 9.
Has it been that many?
Yeah.
I lost count, too.
Uh-huh.
You know, we don't have to keep track of these things.
Uh-huh.
Not in soap operaville.
Uh-huh, but you've had many leading ladies. The character is certainly...
Some wonderful ones. Julia Barr and Marcy Walker.
Uh-huh.
And Ellen Wheeler.
Uh-huh.
Oh, Ellen. She was wonderful. She's the one that had AIDS.
Uh-huh.
Good ones. Pretty mm-hmm. good ones.
Maybe if I were to associate with each one, you could just give me a reaction. Like Julia Barr, who played Brooke English. She was...
Julia Barr is
on the show
a very good personal friend,
mm-hmm.
as is Marcy Walker. Julia Barr, we're talking about now, is one of the best actors I know. She, you got to watch your step, because once in a while I step slightly over the edge in terms of believability and reality. And Julia is totally believable in everything she does. My wife loves her too. She said, yeah, I saw Julia again today. Absolutely, totally believable. And a good friend and a very smart woman. Same with Marcy.
Julia Barr has spent more than 25 years playing Brooke English on All My Children.
It looked like an interesting role. I knew that she was sort of a spitfire.
Why didn't you mind your own business?
I knew that her aunt was Ruth Warwick in the form of Phoebe Wallingford.
She came to live with me, but she was a naughty little girl. She was sleeping around.
Well, I hope you're not going to take your vows of celibacy too soon.
Brooke's first relationship was with Erica Kane's half-brother, Mark.
The character fell in love with a music professor by the name of Mark Dalton at the university, and it was not reciprocal, and so in order to make him jealous, she started to carry on with this guy who was a little bit sleazy, and it actually ended in a date rape.
I told you to shut up!
Don't you touch me, you sleaze!
But it matured her so that the next love of her life was the character of Tom Cudahy.
Will you marry me?
We actually ended in divorce, almost simultaneously that I was giving birth to our daughter, Laura.
But Tom was Erica's former husband.
I know how you try to sabotage my marriage. Oh, you are so low. There is no word for a woman as low as you are.
Erica's MO has always been to sort of flatten, you know, the competition.
You're nothing but a husband-stealing little tramp.
With your strength, I could be the man you want me to be.
Adam and Brooke got together, and it really was quite a dynamic duo because they were at opposite ends of the spectrum. I think anytime you have a storyline where you feel well matched with another person, you know, it makes you step up to bat more.
It's Laura.
Oh my God.
Look, she's been hit by a car.
No.
She died almost immediately.
No. No. No.
She will not come back.
Don't say that! Don't say that!
I remember reading that script, and I get tearing out. It's like, I felt so depressed when I first read it. And I remember David Canary said to me, he goes, oh my God. He said, I was home and I read it, and he said, and I was looking out the window, and for a minute I thought I didn't have my children.
I want to tell her that she's going to be all right, and she will be.
Even though people survive and they go on and they live productive lives, I think sometimes you feel guilty all the time. And in certain ways you sabotage yourself or you don't allow yourself to be truly, truly happy.
I should go home.
It's been an interesting journey on a number of levels. I can't imagine having done anything different than this profession.
You have put up with a lot from me, haven't you?
It was a beautiful experience, and still is.
I've been a working actress over 25 years, so I guess you could say my dream has been fulfilled.